Today on the Mr. Maple Show, we have legendary plantsman Tom Cox. We're going to be discussing everything from rare conifer species to some of the maples he's grown here at the Cox Arboretum to Tom's book, as well as some of his amazing travels.
The Cox Arboretums and Gardens is a private estate located in Canton, Georgia. Canton is approximately 40 miles north of Atlanta in the foothills of the Piedmont Range. Numbering over 4,000 living specimens, the plantings display one of the largest private collections of the temperate flora of the United States. With an elevation of 1,200 feet and containing several lakes and streams, we were able to grow a wide variety of plants in our Zone 7B climate. The property is also bounded by several large wetland habitats, where many migratory and native fowl make their home. It is situated in 13 acres in the middle of an old-growth southern deciduous hardwood forest containing many large oaks, hickory, poplar, and sweet gum, which some are over 100 years old. The Arboretum was started by Tom and Evelyn Cox in 1990 with the purpose of collecting garden-worthy plants. Throughout the years, the mission has evolved with the present focus on plant evaluation, preservation of rare and endangered flora, and to develop public appreciation and enlightenment of plants. It also serves a scientific and educational purpose through testing and displaying new and rare plants in a garden setting. Tom served as the national president of the American Conifer Society from 2006 to 2008. He now travels the world in search of conifers that might be adaptable to the southeastern United States. Along with Dr. John Reuter, he co-authored a first ever book on conifers for the South, Landscaping with Conifers and Ginkgos for the Southeast.
Hey, without further ado, we're here in the makeshift studio. We've actually commandeered Tom's kitchen here. We're in the Mr. Maple podcast with Mr. Tom Cox.
Well, as I say down south, I'm in high cotton. I've known these two gentlemen for a lot of years, and they certainly enjoy a great name and reputation in the world of maples. And since our first introduction, they have expanded that to include ginkgos and a lot of other what I call garden-worthy plants. So welcome, gentlemen. We're delighted to have you and your staff here with us today. A little bit about the Cox Arboretum above and beyond your excellent introduction there. I'd say sometime that that was the second best introduction I've ever had. The best introduction I ever had is when the person who was going to introduce me got sick and I had to introduce myself. So that was the best one. Anyway, we came here in 1990, and current focus today is really a lot about endangered plants. So preservation is a huge part of this. We've amassed today, and it surprises a lot of people, but the best conifer species collection in all of North America, which includes Mexico and Canada, of course. So huge species collection. We find this area is really a sweet spot for plants growing down here. We get a fair amount of rain. It's warm enough to satisfy a lot of the chill plants from South America and Central America, as well as it's cool enough to provide the chill requirements from plants growing in northern latitudes. So we can grow a lot of plants here. It's a great place to grow and garden. Today, in addition to all of the conifer species, we work with a lot of growers and institutions to bring in new cultivars of plants that are new to the industry. Many of them dwarf or pendulous, mm-hmm. spreading, what have you, variegated. We've always had a love for maples. Maples has always played a key role in our work here. And fortunately, working with the Nichols boys, I say boys, they're a lot younger than me, so I can still call them boys, I guess. But they have, I'm sure, the best maple inventory anywhere, at least in America. It's amazing what they've done. So you're here to talk about us, I guess, and we're here on a cool fall day. We're enjoying some of the best fall weather, I think, that we'll see all year. So you hit it just about right.
Oh, an accompaniment to this podcast, we've also done a walkthrough of the Cox Arboretum here. You'll definitely have to catch that on the Mr. Maple Show on YouTube. We'll be doing a full video there on that. And we're just honored. I, it's funny you mentioned a little bit about us, but I definitely could say Tom's known us since we were our smallest. He saw us when we were at tailgate markets. He would come by and give us a word of encouragement. And he's a big part of why our nursery took off. He allowed us to come here and get cuttings pretty early on. And Tim and I would be running around the Cox Arboretum here, obtaining cuttings off things that Dad didn't have in his collection and high-fiving each other and getting excited. And, yeah, we just appreciate your generosity. You've really been a big part of what helped us get going. Tom, I wanted to ask you a little bit. We know you're world-famous for conifers. What inspired your love for conifers? Was there a moment when it kind of clicked and you said, like, this is my passion and I really want to devote, you know, so much of my attention to conifers?
So we started here in 90. Along about 2000, we were approached by the American Conifer Society looking for a place to host a national meeting in Atlanta. Prior to that, I had always collected conifers without thinking about them being conifers. They were evergreen plants, such as rhododendron, hollies, azaleas, even ivy. Mm-hmm. We planted these for winter interest. The winters here always seem longer to me than they are. We don't have long winters compared to, say, Michigan or Minnesota or somewhere. So it's a short life, but I was looking for winter interest. And honestly, at that time, I don't think I'd ever thought about a conifer being a conifer. So when the American Conifer Society approached us, I began to collect even more. And we got our start with conifers primarily up at Yadkin Valley Nursery, mm-hmm. Yadkinville, North Carolina. And they're the ones that told the ACS that we existed down here. So we did host a 2001 meeting. And that was a big success here. We had several hundred people in here from all over. Wow. And just had a great day, rain that day. But anyway, that was the genesis, really, of me getting involved with conifers. And then I began to study them and found them very fascinating. They're some of the oldest plant groups on Earth. They're a gymnosperm, that is, they bear their seeds naked. The ovary is not enclosed in an ovule. So they were around before our modern flowering plants, such as oak and hickory and maple. So they're survivors. Mm-hmm. And that fascinated me. And the more I studied them and the more I study them today, still, I find them unique. And some of the foliage you look at, and it just looks like something dinosaurs would have munched on.
Right. So I think I know the answer to this. I've talked to you extensively before, but for our listeners, what is your favorite conifer species that you're growing here at the Cox Arboretum?
Yeah, you do know the answer, but it is a plant out of Taiwan primarily. It's called Taiwania, and the epithet is Cryptomyrioides. That's a mouthful. It rolls off your tongue pretty easily. Cryptomyrioides. So anyway, it is a plant indigenous to Taiwan. It's also called the Taiwan coffin tree. The wealthy use it for coffins. There's also a mainland form that's disputably whether it's a distinct species or a variety called Fluiciana, but it is the most graceful of all conifers that we grow here, and they get quite large We have one that was wild collected from Mount Morrison in Taiwan, the tallest mountain in the country. And that's, I would say definitely that is the our choice conifer.
So we've talked about your favorite species. And this is Tim here for everyone listening. We know you love the conifer species. You've got so many rare species here, but you've also got a lot of cultivar selections of conifers as well. You've got dwarf sweeping selections, so many different things that you've got here that you talk about in your book, Landscaping with Conifers and Ginkgos in the South. Of all your cultivars that you have of conifers, what is your all-time favorite conifer? Dwarf conifer, or what is your all-time conifer cultivar? Could be dwarf, could be variegated, could be anything.
Matt, what is your favorite child of your three?
Right. Well, let me get specific.
So let me, you come out of left field with that one on me a little bit. I would say, as a genus, Cryptomeria. Mm-hmm. We are known here as having probably, and I feel we probably do have the best Cryptomeria collection. So of that, there is a species, well, it's only one species, Japonica, and that's it. There's not any other species. But that certainly is as a genera, mm-hmm. It's by far the best and the one that I like the most. So species-wise, one in particular stands out, and I may be losing it right now. It's a little oriental spruce, Picea being spruce, Picea orientalis, out of the Caucasus, and it's one called Little Sky, or L-I-L, Lil
okay.
Sky,
yeah.
Which, again, I may be losing that plant, but God, what a darling of a little plant. Darling is not a very masculine term.
Is that one that has more of the yellow color to it, or more of the...
Yellow, and it's yellow year-round. It's dwarf, pyramidal, sort of like a Christmas tree-like, but probably not going to exceed 3 or 4 feet in the landscape, but just makes a nice foil amongst other conifers. And as a species... Mm-hmm. I would say for the South, that is the ticket for here, is growing the oriental spruce as well.
I know you've mentioned a little bit about the Cryptomeria japonicas you've got here, and you seem to find that they do so well here in this Canton, Georgia area, all these different Cryptomeria japonica selections. And you've got an area that's fairly wooded, where they get a little bit of shade, and they get a fair amount of sunlight as well. Do you think that Cryptomerias are a little more shade tolerant than some of the other conifers? Or do they think they just like this area? What about this area do you think that makes Cryptomeria japonica grow so well here?
Well, one of the things, and if you went back in our coffee area, you'd see a big globe. And whenever I look for plants that I think have suitability here, the first thing I look at is latitude. To digress for a moment, Metasequoia, the Don Redwood, mm-hmm. If you go around the globe and you look latitudinally where that was found, it's about Macon, Georgia. So you kind of extrapolate from that and think about, okay, that plant is growing, we're about 34 degrees here. Mm-hmm. And so we can assimilate a lot of plants that around that latitude. So I think that's one thing, is that the climate is very similar here. And there's some cultivars that don't do well here, those that have the juvenile foliage, like elegans is an example. They're very prone for diseases. But to your point about the shade tolerance, yeah, they're an adaptable mm-hmm. plant. They grow in full sun. And they will grow in semi-shade. They're not going to prosper in full shade, but as long as you're getting 4 hours or so of good sun. And the deer seem to leave them alone, which is a problem for a lot of folks out there, mm-hmm. your listeners, that they're plagued by both deer rub as well as deer browse. And A deer rub, I don't know of a conifer that is not prone to that.
Mm-hmm.
But the browse, they don't seem to care for cryptomeria.
Tom, I know you've traveled extensively, either with the American Conifer Society or on your own privately. What are some of your favorite plant travels? I know you've been all around the world. I mean, we could do a Tom's the most interesting guy in the world video easily. He could be the Dos Equis guy here. But Tom's been everywhere, traveling, studying plants. What are some of your more memorable or some of your favorite plant travels you've been on?
Yeah, we've been fortunate somewhere along the way, and I think we can thank the internet and Facebook for some of that, but we got pretty well known. Mm-hmm. I don't want to sound like I'm overly bragging here, but we became known internationally, and as an example, Russia,
mm-hmm.
a country I knew nothing about, really. We're in St. Petersburg. Well, before going, yeah. I was able to make contact with the leading authority in Russia on conifers. And he gave us a full day of his time. He even picked us up and brought us to his place. Certainly visiting there and going through their conservatory and seeing plants with ribbons on them. And I asked him, his name was Gennady. And so I said, what's the significance of the ribbons? They survived Leningrad, the siege at Leningrad. So being with this person, he didn't speak good English, but seeing what he'd done and just realizing, and I'm sitting here with it's almost I want to pinch myself.
Wow.
Here I am with a leading authority in Russia on conifers.
Yeah.
Same thing in Mexico, which is a country that for even folks like mm-hmm. you, there's a lot of Mexican flora that you can grow
mm-hmm.
because of higher elevations.
I think a lot of people don't realize that. They just assume Mexico's extremely hot.
Yeah, they think of it as flat, Clint Eastwood, mm-hmm. you know, the old, you know, old spaghetti westerns. But Mexico has a lot of high elevation. Mm-hmm. The highest mountain east of the Mississippi River, as an example, is Mount Mitchell, North Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's only about 6,200 feet. You go to Mexico, and there's mountains down there, and 18,000 feet, three times as high. And so a lot of snow, mm-hmm. a lot of cold. Well, you bring those plants here, and they work pretty doggone well. So I got to go out. A guy drove 5 hours from Guadalajara over to where we were staying and spent a whole day again with us, took us out into the cloud forest of Mexico. And he had just described a brand new pine, and it was Pinus vallartoensis, like in Puerto Vallarta.
Mm-hmm.
So Pinus vallartoensis, and I was not able physically to go see the pine in situ. So we traveled out into the cloud forest of Mexico, and it may surprise your listeners that the largest species or number of species in the world of pines is Mexico.
Wow.
Also with oak, the genus Quercus. More species down there than any place else in the world. And that was because of the glaciers that pushed plants south, and they could travel down the Appalachian, which ran north and south, and they had an escape route. And they were pushed all the way down into Mexico. And the same thing with the Rockies. Rockies actually extend on into Mexico. So these plants all got pushed down. So it's a sweet spot. Also mentioned travels to China, where I got a chance to lecture there a little bit.
Wow.
And travel out and spent 2 weeks in China. And you guys know Dr. Dave Creech
mm-hmm.
over at Nacogdoches at Stephen F. Austin. And so Dave and I and Mark Wethington, all three of us got to botanize over in China.
Cool.
And that was quite a treat to do that and spend time with the professor over there had hybridized some of the taxodiums to create Nanjing Beauty was one of those. So we got to see fields and fields and fields of those. That's just quite spectacular. And the last one was to Australia.
Oh, cool.
And the very first night I spent was with a guy who wrote, he has the best conifer collection in all of Australia. And him and his wife invited us to stay with them. Had a nice Aussie meal that night, but they could hardly get us out of the field. We were only there for one night. We were there to go to the Australian Tennis Open.
Oh, wow.
And so we had tickets to that, but the guy tried to get us to stay two more nights, and God, that would have been great. But he took us out to see wallaby and koalas and into a rainforest, but to see all the conifers that a lot of them would not grow here.
Oh, I mean, we're doing a podcast. You could do an entire TV show on some of your travels. I think those are incredible.
Oh, they are, yeah.
So, Tom, you know, it's amazing sitting here listening to your stories. It's very interesting to see where you've come from and where you're going with all of your collection of plants over the years. And so, I mean, before you really got into conifers and the world of plants like that, what were some of your other passions? Just as an individual, I'm interested to get to know you as a person and just kind of talk about maybe some of your passions before you got into plants and things you were into.
Well, Brian, I was always into trees, and people ask this question all the time, so I'm just going to jump into it.
Yeah.
If you're okay with that.
Sure.
When I was a little kid, I remember my daddy took me out into the woods, and he didn't know botany. My daddy had a sixth grade education, but he was like many people that lived in the South back then. They lived out in the woods mm-hmm. a lot, and he knew trees. And he would say, this is a hickory, and this is an oak, and this is a maple. And I remember he took an old Barlow knife out of his pocket, and he took some bark off of a hickory and stripped it and plaited a whip. And I had me a little a little whip. Then he made a whistle from a willow tree. And that stuck with me. And I know you're an Oklahoma boy. And as I told you earlier, I used to travel out every summer. We'd come to Muskogee. Trees were a little different out there.
Yeah.
And I had this rabid fascination for different trees, even as a little kid. And I think the genesis probably was from my daddy taking me out in the woods. So then I spent a career in the Army, and I traveled all over the world in the Army. And everywhere I would go, I lived on base. But I would plant trees in the yard or window boxes. I always had my hand in horticulture, even living in Savannah, Georgia one time in an apartment. I had plants growing on a patio. So I'd gone one time to the Far West Show out in Oregon, and these booths out there that people would give you plants to take home, you know. And I'm in the airport, and I had this big duffel bag. A duffel bag's about, probably 7 foot long. And I had these trees, and some of them were so long they were sticking out of the duffel bag. I'm walking through the airport, and the guy stops me, and he says, hey, buddy, you've been here too damn long. You got trees growing out of your suitcase.
Yeah, plant hoarder problems. I've tried using that carry-on for like a 7 gallon. They don't like that too much sometimes.
Oh, no. Well, back in the day, you could get by with that. And people would come. You'd go through the TSA, and I would show them, I'd open it up, and I'd say, look at this, and well, they got fascinated. Well, they would literally stop, and people would, hey, come over here and look at this, come over here and look at that. So anyway, that's, I think, probably for me, that's where the seed was planted, and when we acquired this land, I started what I called a stick arboretum, just planting sticks. Wherever you could get a little plant from whoever would share it with you. And back in those days, there was not internet like there is today when I started. It was mail order. And people that are listening that are old enough will remember the days when you waited in the spring or in the fall to get your fall catalog.
Yeah.
Like getting a Sears and Roebuck catalog, but you get your catalogs. And that was kind of your dream book.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd sleep with it sometime, you know. Then all of a sudden, one day these boxes would show up, and most of it would be deciduous by that time. And
yeah.
You just look at it, you know, and you say to your wife, isn't it beautiful? And you know, she'd say, I'm so proud of you, and you know that she's putting you on. I hope I answered your question
you did.
It's always been my obsession.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Now, you did mention your military kind of background there. I have a younger brother who's in the military, so I can always say I appreciate your service and what you've done in that aspect of. Can you expand on that a little bit and like what you did in the military and what like?
Yeah, I went in 1966, like a lot of folks drafted. Mm-hmm. I was always patriotic, but I didn't care about joining.
Yeah,
honestly. And went to officer candidate school and became a commissioned officer. Spent time in Germany, then went to Vietnam for a year. And I got to say, for those folks out there that might have served or might have a son or a spouse that served, I think everybody would say to you, it might not have been the best choice, but we're all happy we went. Mm-hmm. And we're proud to have served. And those of us that went, I don't want to turn this into a political thing, but we did what we were asked.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
And
underappreciated, for
some
sure,
of our friends didn't
ways.
Come back.
Yeah.
And for that, we grieve. I remember the first time seeing the wall and just such an emotional thing. Makes me almost want to break down now just thinking about that.
I'll tell you, it's one of the few times I ever saw my father cry was when we went to the wall because he didn't know which people from his unit had passed and died. Oh, because,
God bless you.
You know, because of that. So, I mean, it's a memory that I carry seeing my dad do that. And we thank you for your service. That means a lot to us. We, you know, God bless you for that.
Well, I thank you. Thank your brother. Let him know that.
I will.
So, but it was a good career. The Army was good to me. And, I think it helped me grow up, give me some discipline, and give me direction. And I got out and went to work for the phone company. So, rest is history.
Yeah.
You were an executive at Bell South after that, is that true? Richard Bomar gave me some inside tips. I know he's traveled with you a good bit. Shout out to Richard Bomar. He's a good friend of both of ours.
Oh, yeah, good guy. You know, I'll just tell you a sidebar here if you want to block this out later. But we're over in Prague in the Czech Republic. Richard had a girlfriend back then, and one thing I was a stickler for is people. We're in a foreign country. We only got so many days here, and you got to play by the rules. One of the rules is you got to stick together. We can't go wandering off. Well, she wandered off and got lost. And we were on this thing called the Charles Bridge, and it was wall-to-wall people, tourists and locals. And just fantastic. Well, from there, we were going to a restaurant to eat. Well, everybody's all together except Richard's girlfriend.
Uh-oh.
Well, I got to stay back with Richard, and we're trying to find her. Well, we couldn't find her. We looked and looked and looked, and finally, it reached a point there where you got to say, hey, and for the sake of the rest of the paying customers here, we got to get over, get with them in the restaurant. So we get over there. Well, there she was, and we're wondering, how in the heck did she know where we were? Well, it turns out, on the itinerary, it said the restaurant, and she had taken a picture of it and was able to ask people where that restaurant was, and that's how she found it.
I know Richard has many fond memories of sharing rooms with you during ACA meetings and just so many. He's got good stories, too. We'll have to interview Richard on the podcast.
The ACS meeting in Asheville, Richard didn't get on the bus on time as it was moving from one tour to the other, and we all started realizing after the bus had already taken off, when we saw Richard running in a full sprint down the hill to try to catch up with the bus because he didn't make it on the bus when the bus was supposed to leave. He was too busy looking at conifers out in the garden.
So where DeWise in those Plant Society meetings? Well, it's the Maple Society, the ACA. You might get left behind. You better stay with that bus, right?
Stick to the schedule.
Yeah, there's an old boy who lives over your way named Dan Spear. You don't know Dan?
I know, sir. I don't think I do.
Dan is over around Hendersonville, and He's that way. But anyway.
So, Tom, around these gardens, you've got some of the prettiest gardens of anywhere in the Southeast. You've got maples. You've got conifers. You've got rare species. You've got flowering plants. When people think about Cox gardens here in Canton, Georgia. What do you want this garden to be remembered for?
That's a great question, and I really thank you for asking that. That's because it just leads me into something I love talking about. When we started this, and even to this day, I never wanted to create a pretty garden. Pretty gardens to me are pretty gardens, but they're boring. And let me define what a pretty garden is. It's a garden where you've got 10,000 pansies and chrysanthemums, and they got the staff to tear this out and put this in. And I'm not knocking those. They serve a purpose for the masses of people that love to go to gardens. We have a garden up the road up here, Gibbs Garden. It's the most prettiest garden in Georgia, no doubt about it. Beautiful topo, but not particularly botanically interesting, but one heck of a garden. Well, what I wanted here was for people to come and experience plants they'll never see anywhere else. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily pretty. And over time, I learned something else, and that is grow plants well. If it's not going to grow, if it's not meant to be here, don't keep it. Don't have a plant just because you can brag that you got one. Mm-hmm. Secondly, plants ought to be pruned, and they ought to show well. Nothing more off-putting to me than to go to a garden, whether it's your garden or your garden or somebody else. And I don't mind telling you when I'm there, I'm not too shy about that. You need to prune that thing or stake it up or something. It'll look a lot better for you. So we try to grow plants well here. But most of the takeaway for people is I want you to come here. First of all, feel welcome. Mm-hmm. We welcome anybody to visit here. We do ask for a small contribution for people because this is not a cheap place to keep going. And beyond that, experience plants, again, that you won't see elsewhere, mm-hmm. or to realize so many things about a full third of the conifers in the world are endangered.
Yeah.
And today, with habitat loss, clear cutting, fragmentation of species. You go down to Mexico as an example. There's a spruce down there, most endangered plant in all of Mexico, growing right, three of them growing here. I want people to see those and appreciate what's happening and conservation. The other thing is public enlightenment of things. Landscapers, God bless them, I don't think they have enough plant knowledge. They know what they know. And they have a limited palette of landscape plants. For a few years, it was Leyland cypress for a while, and Bradford pears, and now green giants. Mm-hmm. Virtually all of those we've got here. We don't have Bradford pear anymore, good thank God. But so landscapers can come here, and they can see plants that they've never seen before. Mm-hmm. And plants don't read books. Was able to write this book about plants that we've trialed. Mm-hmm. If I read the literature and how many plants here that are zone 9, we're zone 6. Zone 9 is way down in South Florida.
Right.
So that's because some author looked at a book, a reference book, and then he wrote a book using a reference book as his reference, as opposed to growing them.
Yeah.
I can say here, when Dr. Reuter and I wrote this book, we did it hands-on. Mm-hmm. And he was way down in South Georgia, and we're way up here in North Georgia. Mm-hmm. So you had two pretty good areas, and we both gardened. I gardened from a standpoint of getting my hands in the dirt and knowing what would live here. I'm sorry, what was your question again?
No. That you're leading right into our next topic, too, which is about your book. Your book, Landscaping with Conifers and Ginkgos in the Southeast, is a really awesome book. Matt and I both love it, on telling your true opinions on these plants for the Southeast.
And I think that's why that book's been so well received, too.
And I think it tells us the fact, but also tells us your experiences, which is exactly what people need when it comes to a lot of these things. Whenever you were starting your book, what was the moment when you decided to write a book, and what do you think was the thing that pushed you over the edge to actually decide to take all the effort and time into getting this book done?
Yeah, the book took over 3 years to write, but I will remember the day, and it had been in my head for a long time, the frustration. Every book written on conifers, mm-hmm. and most garden books, with the exception of a few from Dr. Durr and others down here, but most of the books that you read, and you guys know this, are written from somebody's perspective from the Northeast, mm-hmm. Pacific Northwest, England, some books in Japanese or what have you. But you didn't have anyone who's ever written a book on conifers and ginkgo from the Southeast, who garden in the Southeast. Well, as you know, the soil is different here, the climate's different here, the challenges we face down here are different. So when I started out, I would go to libraries like at the Atlanta Botanical Garden. I would take my lunch hours. I worked downtown. And the librarian got to know me real well. And every day I would go in there and I would read my lunch hour on conifers and plants, just trees.
Yeah.
And but the experiences didn't line up a lot of times, mm-hmm. what they were saying. Taking nothing away from these authors, I would never do that. But they're not gardening from, they're not writing from a perspective of being here.
Yeah.
So Dr. Reuter and I were standing out there one day right out here in front of the house. And I said, John, I've had this frustration and been kicking this around. Would you like to write a book with me on conifers? And he didn't take him 30 seconds to say, yeah, let's do it. And a lot of this was in my head. And, you know, so we just started, I said, and I wrote most of the plant stuff, and John had knowledge I didn't have. John had knowledge about insects, diseases, and a lot of that stuff. So we were a good match. And also, John knew of, I said, growing down in South mm-hmm. Georgia. One of the things we don't think about enough in the Southeast is heat zones. Mm-hmm. When you pick up a plant tag from Mr. Maple, the first thing you look at is the low number. You don't mm-hmm. think about the high number. And when I was starting out as a neophyte, I'd just look at that low number. It says zone 3, zone 4.
Right.
Bingo, it's going to live here.
Right.
And we lose more plants in August. It's our worst month to lose plants is August. Confluence of high nighttime temperatures, heavy soil, drenching rain.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we get more rain here than does Seattle or Portland.
Wow.
We get 64 inches. The U.S. average is about 40, and we're 63 here. So we get a lot of rain. And then you throw in insects and things. We got called phytophthora or root rot down here. So John was able to contribute so much information from a scientific standpoint, and plus we were good friends. Mm-hmm. And didn't have any egos in this. You write what you know, I write what I know, and then you embellish on what I know. So it was a good marriage, and we talked about a volume 2. Unfortunately, with this disease, I type with about one finger now, and I just probably not going to happen now.
Now, we've talked a lot about the book, and the conifers are taking the starring role here. But there's another part to that, and it's the and ginkgo. Now, you have quite an extensive collection of ginkgo here in the Arboretum as well. How many different cultivars do you think you're growing here of ginkgo trees?
You know, I should have counted them, knowing you was going to hardly only ask that question.
But put you on the spot.
I would say there's between 30 and 40 different ginkgos in here. Ginkgo, I'll just expand on it a little bit. is another one of these fascinating genera. At one time, there were ginkgo native to North America, Europe, different species. And ginkgo was one of the first plants on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
It predated dinosaurs. Ginkgo were actually here, and they predated conifers. So it's the oldest tree on Earth. And one of the interesting things is that leaf is largely unchanged from 180 million years ago.
That's fascinating.
Yeah. Now, you throw that number out, 180 million, if you aren't careful, your brain will bypass the significance of that. But that's a lot of years ago to think about a tree that's still living. The plant, and I don't know who's actually got a copy of this. I hear these stories of one that came from Hiroshima. I do know this. It's been documented. There were two trees that weren't that far from ground zero at Hiroshima that the roots survived. The upper part was blown away, but it actually, came back from the roots. We've got one out here you saw yesterday that survived Chernobyl.
Wow.
So the plant is a survivor.
Right.
And that in of itself makes it something worthy of growing. There's not a visitor here. I can tell you there's not a visitor here. Many of them do not know what ginkgo is.
Mm-hmm.
They've heard of ginkgo biloba, but they have no idea what that is, or if it's even a tree, they wouldn't recognize the leaf. That when they hear the story, do not get fascinated and do not want to go over and take pictures of it and study it. And this time of the year, particularly with the yellow fall color, it just is the icing on the cake. If you're going to grow them down here, wherever you're going to grow them, make sure you're using lime in the soil. I know you guys have talked about that before, one of your podcasts.
It makes a huge difference.
Yeah, and I appreciate that podcast. You guys are spot on.
Now, whenever it comes to ginkgo, they're always grouped in with conifers. I know you're a conifer expert. What is the reasoning behind ginkgos being always grouped in with the conifers?
There's two reasons. One, well, the first of all, they're gymnosperms. For those of you that remember in school, and I don't remember studying this, but I know they taught it, there's two main groups, angiosperms and gymnosperms. The gymnosperms were the first plants on Earth. They bear their seeds naked. And so one of those is ginkgo. Unlike a plum or a cherry, where you've got the plant with the seed enclosed in an ovary. Secondly, they make a good plant with conifers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there some of those little dwarf ones, variegated ones, weeping ones. There's one out there for every application. And so I would say to people, you know, they're mostly going to be through folks like Mr. Ginkgo, a.k.a. Mr. Maple, or mail order places. In the intelligentsia out there, these are plants not hard to find. You just got to know where to look.
Yeah.
You're not going to go to your local nursery and find many cultivars, but they're out there. So that's why they're lumped together. They're just great foils. Great foils of Japanese maple.
Yeah. So, Tom, moving on from ginkgos, you mentioned them being a great pairing with Japanese maples. I wanted to ask you, what makes Japanese maples so much better than conifers? I'm joking, of course. Really, what I wanted to ask you is why Japanese maples pair so well with conifers. You have, you know, we joke about your collection here with conifers, but you have an amazing Japanese maple collection here at the Cox Arboretum as well. There's some unrivaled cultivars for size. You have some beautiful specimens of Japanese maples here. What do you think about it that makes that pairing so well with conifers and Japanese maples?
Well, first of all, I think I mentioned earlier to you off camera that some of our very first plantings here were Japanese maples. Many of them have very dainty, lacy foliage, as do some of the conifers, like some of the Chemosuperus, the Cryptomeria, both having Japanese origins. I think that's part, I hadn't really thought about that till just now. But that's in my head as I'm thinking about this, that's a very good point, I think, is they both have Japanese origins.
Yeah.
Both are very old. Mm-hmm. You go back in the literature, we talked about Tim Yukiyami, Japanese maple, and I knew that was in the catalogs in the 1800s.
Yeah, yeah.
We think about some of these cryptomeria, and most of them had their origins, again, in the Japanese. As a country, we're young.
Right.
Yes.
The Japanese were collecting this stuff hundreds and hundreds of years before we were even a country.
That's a great point.
And so all this stuff is out there. And I said, you go back and you look at these catalogs. Uh-huh. So I think the symbiotic relationship, and I use that term loosely here, but you see this connection of the two. Also, the fall colors of Japanese maples against some of the dark greens. Many times, people that come here, they make this comment, and it's funny how it just repeats itself, that didn't realize there were so many shades of green in the world.
Right.
So they're able to look out there, and they could see all these different conifers. And then juxtapose with those, or particularly this time of the year, are the reds and the yellows of the Japanese maples, and also forms.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great thing people miss sometimes in mixing plants together, is you got to think about, okay, the form and the texture.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the textures are similar between conifers and Japanese maples.
If you're already at that high level of attention to detail, you're going to notice all these different nuances and that make the conifers different, that make the Japanese maples different. It's like the, you know, I'm a bit biased, obviously. We do Mr. Maple and we do a lot of conifers, but it's like that upper level of plant collecting. You've reached a sophisticated level when you're collecting conifers and maples that you're noticing more nuances that might not be there with more simple plants.
Yeah, I talked about earlier with you when we were just kind of walking around that winter interest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, learning to be a four-season gardener, and there's a high number, and I say high, I emphasize high number of conifers that, not conifers, Japanese maples that have this great shape in the winter.
Mm-hmm.
I look out here at these Tim Yukiyamis in the front yard,
or
the Ryusons in the front yard, right? You know, I'm going to digress for a moment. One of the things that I talk about with every visitor here, you look in the front yard, huge Japanese cryptomeria, cryptomite, the parodia. And I say to people, and Acer Miyabi, which nobody knows that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But I say, we only put connoisseur plants in the front yard.
Mm-hmm.
The stewardia right out there across the street. So four of the connoisseur plants in our front yard, their stewardia, the styrax, all these plants, is Japanese maples.
Yeah.
Tim Yukiyami and Ryusen.
Mm-hmm.
And then Acer Miyabi, so five actually right there in the front yard. I think that is when you combine winter interest with the evergreen nature of conifers and knowing the structure of maples, the fall mixture of colors, and spring, and also many conifers change colors in the winter, and it makes a nice foil against the structure.
I was thinking just as you were talking about this, and you were talking about all the different colors that the conifers go through, and I was just thinking about how many thousands of selections of conifers there are, from Japanese white pines to Japanese black pines to cryptomeria to Camas cyprus. I mean, you go down the list, there's so much of a selection. And with Japanese maples, it's the same way. We have over 1,400 varieties of Japanese maples. And you start looking at it, and it makes a lot of sense because people can paint their yards with black and white, which the common stuff that you see around, or they can add color and really use all these different options they have in front of them, which by adding color, it could be form. I mean, there's so much variation to work with conifers and Japanese maples that they have something that they can deal with to complement each other, and there's just more to work with. I mean, it gives you so many more options for your landscape and garden.
Well, as you walk around here, I don't know if it occurred to you, but as you walk around here, Wesley, you'll maybe think about, you don't see a lot of bloom here right now, but there is one heck of a lot of color. Because
mm-hmm.
we learned, I hope we learned, I think we did, how to color without using flowers. I'm not anti-flowers.
Mm-hmm.
We're now shifting a lot of our focus now to herbaceous material because we're running out of space. And I showed you the little plant yesterday that you shared with us out in the Shadeland garden out there. But and conifers aren't real fussy.
Yeah.
They're not real fussy plants. So you don't have to spend a lot of time with them. Not a lot of heavy pruning, but we talked about making this an educational place.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to end with this on this, and that is, I get people up close, and I say, look at this little Japanese maple. Now, you're standing over here about where Wesley is. You're not going to appreciate that, but get up here and look at it up close.
Mm-hmm.
Look at that subtle variegation that you're seeing on that leaf margin. Or look at the reticulation you're seeing on Peaches and Cream in the spring. Now, if you don't get up and look at that up close, you'll miss that.
Uh-huh.
And you'll miss that on some of these conifers. Get up in that plant's face and enjoy it. Appreciate it.
Tom, that kind of leads me into a question I've been wanting to ask you. So spending a lot of time here today. Touring out here in the gardens has been amazing, and I've seen so many maples, you know, and at Mr. Maple, you know, we have a lot of southern gardeners that buy from us here, and you know, talking about southern gardens and landscaping in southern gardens, do you have a couple of maybe just like top performers or favorite maples that you could recommend for southern gardeners who are kind of maybe looking to get that first maple or just, you know, getting into the world of maples and say they're in the South and they're looking for something specific. Do you have a couple of recommendations for that?
Yeah, and I'm going to base that on how they perform here. I guess because they're good performers or favorites. First one that I mentioned several times is Tim Yukiyami. I'm a huge proponent of that plant. I really like Geisha Gone Wild.
Okay, yeah.
It has a good color metamorphosis
throughout
the season. It doesn't particularly wow me in the winter, but I love that plant. I'm becoming enamored with Gable's Glory again for that metamorphosis of color changes.
Yeah, I know where you got that one.
yeah, I bet you do. I would say Syria.
Yeah.
Again, it's going to get large.
Yeah, you have a beautiful specimen down there that we...
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Doesn't have to get large, but it can. On the species level, Acer grisium, a good connoisseur plant. If you're looking for winter interest or bark interest, which all your listeners, if they're not doing that now, I encourage you to think about barks. The old Sangu Kako, which for a long time I just considered a pedestrian plant. But the fall color, I would never say grow it for that coral bark. I think it loses that for muss here, and I don't get wild about that. But again, a tough plant, a plant that's not going to disappoint you in the fall.
Yeah.
It's going to always have reliable fall color and good leaf retention. So like that one a lot. Ryusin, I don't think I mentioned that again. That's one of my very favorites. Again, strong performer. Geisha's, I'm not going to do Geisha. Edgewood, another one out there. I don't see that one around.
Yeah.
English lace I got from you guys.
Mm-hmm.
Again, a good plant.
Yeah.
You don't see that enough.
Yeah.
Every time you guys mention it, I always put a comment in there talking about a great plant it is.
So, Tom, we know that you've got this amazing book. I know that you're one of the top conifer and ginkgo experts. What tips would you have for people who are just starting gardening for growing conifers and ginkgos in the Southeast?
Buy the book.
Well, where can they get your book?
Okay. they can contact me at coxgardens.com or on the website. It's a place, there's a contact form on there to contact me. I'll be glad to autograph one, mail it to you. You'll get it in a few days. Secondly, it's out there still on Amazon. And that's two locations. Some bookstores have it, but it's still available. I said in some bookstores. But Amazon, definitely. But contacting me may be the best way, and you get an autographed copy that way.
I've got an autographed copy. So, again, you can contact Tom through coxgardens.com. That's one of the best ways to get an autographed copy. Is it also a way people can contribute or learn to volunteer here at your garden?
Yes. There is, again, a volunteer form on there. My email address is on the website. I'll just go ahead and give you that now. It doesn't bother me. COXARB, like Alpha Romeo Bravo, the number 2 at gmail.com.
Well, Tom, we really appreciate you jumping on our podcast today, talking to people about conifers, what got you into gardening, and why you love conifers, ginkgos, and maples so much. We really appreciate your expertise and everything that you've contributed to gardening throughout the years. You've been a lot to us, and everything that you've helped us out with, and it means so much to us that you've came on our podcast. We really appreciate it.
Well, guys, this is a mutual admiration society here between us. I'll just close with this. There's a lot of me in this place, and I'm very proud of it from the standpoint of what's here. And thank you for the opportunity to get the word out further. Our daughter is taking this over one day, so it's going to be held as a trust set up. So hopefully I don't mean to sound self-aggrandizing by saying this, but what I started here will continue on and just get better and better and better.
Oh, it's a special thing.
Yeah, I know you guys will continue to be a supporter of this place.
Oh, for sure.
After I'm gone.
It's an amazing friendship we've developed here, Tom. I mean, you were at my wedding. You remember that downpour of rain? I think we both outkicked our coverage. We both married well. You and Evelyn have been good friends of ours for many years, from coming to our wedding to being a big supporter of Mr. Maple. We really appreciate all your support over the years. So we're humbled and honored that you and Evelyn would invite us into your home, allow us to do this podcast, and again, shoot some great footage around your gardens here. It's a special place, and we hope to help share that with others through this.
It's been our pleasure. Please do. And thanks for coming.
Hey, y'all. Thanks for watching today's video, today's podcast. Thanks for listening. For all your listeners out there, we really appreciate it. Make sure you subscribe to us on your favorite podcast platform. We're on all major platforms now. We're putting out weekly videos, and they'll be airing every Sunday. And they'll be airing the video portion of this every Sunday at 8 p.m. on YouTube.
Take care,
God bless,
and have an awesome day.